Well, amen. Good morning. How are you? All right. Glad to hear it. Exciting times here at First Baptist Boerne. If you don't know, this morning is the beginning of we are taking deacon nominations over the next several weeks, and so it's the first time in 5 years that we are going through the process of taking deacon nominations, and so we're going to be talking about that specifically and directly, and how all of it ties into covenant care and covenant membership. So on the 23rd of May, there was kind of this unveiling, the beginning of a conversation as we had walked through the book, the middle section of Ephesians and church matters. And on May 23rd, I just talked about kind of the need for our church to move towards more meaningful membership and what that looks like and what we're proposing and the way that deacons will come in line with what we're calling covenant care. Okay, that is, everyone who becomes a covenant member will have assigned a deacon as a family unit, and deacons will have flocks, and they will help us extend care in regards to knowing our people more and being able to pray with them and check on them, really important shepherding care, okay? But I need to show you this morning through Acts chapter 6. Go ahead and turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 6, where and how we formulate some of these ideas of church leadership, what it looks like, and deacons, okay? And so even though this passage doesn't specifically call the seven men who are raised up, most theologians tend to think this is the beginning stages of deaconship and where they come and how they're instituted within the church, okay? One other important passage that as you think in your own study towards deacons is going to be out of 1 Timothy chapter 3, okay? But this morning we're going to walk through Acts chapter 6. I'm going to read the first seven verses, and we're going to look at what was taking place in the church, the context, and the need for deacons. Listen as I read Acts 6, 1. Now at this time, while the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint arose on the part of the Hellenistic Jews against the native Hebrews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily serving of food. So the 12 summoned the congregation of the disciples and said, "It is not desirable for us to neglect the word of God in order to serve tables. Therefore, brethren, select from among you seven men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we may put in charge of this task. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." The statement found approval with the whole congregation, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch. And these they brought before the apostles, and after praying, they laid hands on them. And the word of God kept on spreading, and the number of the disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful that your word provides instruction to us for how we are to do church. Father, we trust you, and we trust that you have preserved your word for us. Father, as a church, as we are at a critical, very important time, we pause to pray for your direction, for your vision, for your leaders, that we would rise up, continue to move forward as a congregation, that we would constantly be improving, sanctified, as we walk out collectively as a body for the glory of your name. It is our deep, deep desire to see the name of Jesus Christ high and lifted up.
Glory.
Here at First Baptist Boerne, and that you might use us to take your gospel throughout this community and to the ends of the earth. We love you. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. The 12 apostles and a small group of disciples have locked themselves in an upper room. They are in intense prayer, no doubt fearful of the Romans and of the Jewish leadership of the day. Jesus had given them specific instruction: do not leave Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes. And then on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the Passover, after Jesus' death and resurrection, the Holy Spirit fell like never before. There was a giant rushing noise of wind that stirred up commotion that could be heard all through the city. And inside that upper room, there were these flames of fire that looked like tongues upon them. It was the specific moment, the switch between the Holy Spirit kind of coming intermittently upon the sons and daughters of God in the Old Testament to moving to permanently indwelling and the New Testament church being born, you and I becoming the temple of God. And a crowd gathered around. They had heard all the commotion, and a crowd gathered around. They wanted to see, to know what was going on. It was such a violent noise that thousands. And Peter stood up and preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Repent and believe in the name of Jesus Christ, the one and only name given underneath heaven by which man must be saved. And 3,000 were saved that day. 3,000 were saved that very moment. I mean, can't you imagine? This drastic change from fear to victory. And just like that, the church was born. I mean, you are right there in the midst of just a revival, a movement of God, that the church was born. And in the first 3 years, right there in Jerusalem, one of the most incredible truths about Jesus and about the church is that it was birthed right there in Jerusalem. And the book of Acts tells us that thousands and thousands had come to faith. Multitudes of men and women. I mean, this is the climax of the early church, filled with excitement. I mean, you have to think God is doing incredible things. Even men and women that are pretending to be more holy than they are, they're struck dead right there on the spot. You got to think everything is just perfect. It's just grand. Nothing could go wrong. And then you get to Acts chapter 6. And you realize that, as always, there are growing pains. You see, a division has occurred. Not by malice, simply because growing pains, administration, logistics, not being able to keep up with this incredible explosion of growth. See, apparently, the Hellenistic widows were being neglected with food distribution. Now, in the first century, a woman had very little earning power in the marketplace. And so once she had become a widow, she was very vulnerable. And if she did not have a family to take care of her, well, she needed the church family. And think about if as she had become a Christian, her biological family might have rejected her. And she needed a church family to come around and to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Now, this food ministry probably also consisted of some clothing along with some monetary help and support. Before we get lost into the details of the controversy, let's make sure to pause and notice and realize that the early church is putting its faith into action. James 1:27. Pure and undefiled religion in the sight of our God and Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Well, you may ask, Pastor, do we, First Baptist Boerne, do we care for those who are the least of these? Yes, we do. And I want to pause and I want you to realize, I want you to be proud of our following the scripture and what we do to care for those who are in help. We have regular ongoing benevolence ministry that's run by the deacons to pay the water bills and light bills to meet immediate needs. Additionally, we have partnerships with local Christian organizations like Hill Country Daily Bread or Hill Country Pregnancy Center that we fund, that we volunteer, and that many of you are in leadership positions at. Furthermore, we have set aside designated money for emergency relief so that when crisis pops up, like COVID, we can reach out to our local and international mission partners and be even more generous because we know we're meeting immediate, desperate needs at the moment. Now, I share all of that with you because you need to know what our money goes towards. And as we read scripture, you need to be thinking, well, it's great that the early church cared for the widows and those in need, but what are we doing? So back to Acts chapter 6, it says that the Hellenistic widows were being overlooked in the food distribution. Now, it's estimated that about 15 to 20% of the early church were Hellenistic Jews, in contrast to what you call the Hebrew Jews, okay? Now, as you know, in many cultures, in every culture, there are those who lean more conservative and preserving traditions, and then those who would lean more liberal and are more in line with change and moving forward, right? And there are people on all areas, all spots on the spectrum of the whole thing, right? Well, most of the religious Jews spoke Hebrew in church and when they were amongst each other. But many had embraced the Roman or the Greek culture and had not learned to speak Hebrew, so they only spoke Greek. These are what is known as Hellenistic Jews, okay? About 15 to 20% of the early church. But what you need to understand is that because of the the spectrum of conservative and a little more liberal and all along the way, what you need to understand is here in this situation, there are real linguistic and cultural differences that have popped up within the church. Real cultural differences. And then Christ comes and saves everyone on the spectrum. One gospel, one spirit, one new man, all put together in the same church. And so a division has arisen, unintentional as it may be, and it strikes a nerve because it threatens unity and the culture of the church. Are the same cultural divides that exist outside the walls of the church, do they exist in here? Is there an inside group and an outside group? Is it an us versus them whenever we get in here? And if you've been around churches very long, you know how these complaints get started and how they sound. Well, I heard that Peter visited sister so-and-so the other day. Well, he's never visited me. And then talk and chatter begins that. Well, he's never visited me either. I heard he visited sister so-and-so over there too. And pretty soon it's like, well, wait a second. We all speak Greek. I guess we're on the outside looking in. I guess there's cliques within this church. I guess it's us versus them. And do you want to know what? The scripture says their complaint was legitimate. The Bible doesn't say that it was gossip or something silly over arguing the color of the carpet. It's a legitimate complaint. So watch what they do. They call the whole congregation together to address the issue. Remember, we're only getting summary form, but I want you to imagine in your mind a town hall. And the leaders stand up, the apostles stand up and say, hey, this has been brought to our attention. Someone gets mad and yells out, yeah, we're just like the world. You guys talk about being different, but we're really no different. I want you to notice the dialogue that exists right here in the text. It's embedded in there. I want you to notice the shepherding heart of the apostles. They don't lead from way up on a pedestal. They are right there in the midst of the people. They care about even the least of these and want to make sure that these problems get addressed, that they're not ignored. But the reality is there's only so much time. If Peter spends all of his time passing out bread to widows, verse 2 and verse 4 say he would have to neglect the preaching of the word and prayer. One question I get asked all the time is, Pastor, how much time do you spend preparing a sermon each week? Well, truth be told, about 15 to 20 hours each week goes into studying the scripture, goes into praying about where it should go and how it should be addressed to you, goes into writing out all my canned jokes that you guys think are so funny. Now, the rest of my time is spent leading staff, counseling appointments, phone calls, home visits. Many of you write me letters, most of which are very encouraging. A few of them are critical and challenging at points. I want you to know I read every word and I pray over every detail, even if I don't have time to write back. And of course, I have meetings, and more meetings. And as stuff piles on, and every week is different, okay? And I deeply desire to be a good shepherd, to be there, and so does my whole staff, to know you and to get involved in life and living out this Christian life. But as time is always of a crunch, let me ask you, what do you think gets cut each and every week in regards to all the things that I have to get done and fires that get put out? It's always prayer and sermon prep time. And the Bible says that's not good. It's not good to mix up priorities of what ultimately God would say is the highest priority. You need to know that I preach this truth to myself all the time as I'm pulled every different direction, because I want you to know how much I care for you, how much I want to get to know you, and so does my whole staff. But as I get pulled from here to here to here, at some point I have to cut lines off and just go, you know what, God? It is not good. What you want is for your word to be proclaimed and for it to be prayed over before it's presented to the people. And there's only so much time. And there's only so much of me. So now I want you to look. I want you to see what they do. Look again at verse 3. Therefore, brethren, select from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, who we may put in charge of this task. They get the congregation to select leaders from within themselves. The congregation to select leaders from within themselves. Think about how this could have gone. The apostles are there and leading, okay? Who would know any better than the apostles? Right? Couldn't they go pray and just get a special word from the Lord and God said, call this person, and just come back and go, guys, here it is. This is what God said. Do that. I mean, even when choosing the 12th apostle, they cast lots and they relied on God. But here, the congregation selects their own leaders from within. Laymen, right? They didn't send them off to seminary, as good as seminary is. They didn't send them off to seminary and then go, come back after you're trained. We'll receive you back in about 5 or 6 years. No, no, no. 7 men full of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom. Now, later, the office of deacon, as it gets a little more defined, you can read in Paul's letter, 1 Timothy chapter 3, he gives a list of qualifications, but in truth, this is a very good summary of what he says in 1 Timothy chapter 3. Men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and of wisdom. Now, they chose 7 men, and they're listed in verse 5. Beginning with Stephen and Philip. Now, maybe you've heard, and it's been pointed out, that all 7 have Greek names. Now, you need to understand that it was common in this day and time for Jewish men to have Greek names. And if you follow the context, the first two that are introduced, Stephen and Philip, okay, particularly Stephen, you get so much history and details about what Stephen does next, how he goes and he preaches before the Sanhedrin and they end up stoning him, that it's pretty safe to assume Stephen and probably Philip were of the Jewish, Hebrew-speaking Jews, okay? But the other 5 names that are listed there, they're actually very uncommon names for Jewish men to have. They're very Hellenistic Greek names. And the final one, Nicholas, it actually says that he was a proselyte. Now, what that means is that he was a Gentile who had been converted to Judaism. He was a Gentile who had joined in with Judaism, and then he became a believer in Jesus Christ. So catch this picture and put it all together. The Hellenistic widows are being ignored. It's a very important issue. It strikes a nerve. Are we any different? There are cultural divides out there, but when we get in here, are we any different, right? We get that severity. So the congregation appoints probably two Hebrew-speaking Jews, four Hellenistic Jews, and one Gentile to stand right alongside the apostles there in Jerusalem. They didn't say, you know what, all you Hellenistics, everyone go to the right and we'll appoint some Hellenistics over here and you guys just kind of take care of yourself because we are so tired of messing with this. It's just too messy. You guys form your group. Well, they didn't do that. You have this magnificent picture of leadership that rises up from within the church. And this is not like an only case deal. So right here, as you work through the early church, you have Greek and Gentile men serving in prominent leadership roles, deacon roles. In 1 Corinthians, you have women prophesying in the church. And in Philemon, you have this picture of slaves being redeemed, of having their freedom purchased back, and even slaves serving in prominent positions within the church. Absolutely magnificent picture of what they fought for and the way that they fought for unity. I need you to notice two things that don't happen. First of all, they don't limit the spread of the gospel, God's word going forward, by being unorganized or small-minded. Well, if Peter doesn't serve me bread, then it means he doesn't love me. They don't do that. God's word, prayer over God's word, must stay a priority in the church. If we are not careful, as a culture, we will raise a host of pastors who are anything but dedicated to the preaching of God's word and to prayer. Entrepreneurs, innovative, creative, visionary, cool, social media savvy, but neglect the preaching and prayer of God's word. Secondly, you know what else they don't do? They don't ignore shepherding. Well, just let the sheep fend for themselves. I mean, really, are widows good for growing the church? I mean, they kind of just suck resources, right? I mean, shouldn't we just let them? They slow progress. Now, we would never be so crass as to speak like that, but shepherding gets sacrificed all the time in the name of progress. Am I speaking to us in our culture? Does shepherding not get sacrificed all the time in the name of progress? Ezekiel 34, God laments that the leaders in the Old Testament, they were shepherds who devoured the sheep. They ate the sheep. They sacrificed the sheep all for their own good, for their own profit. And God laments. And he says, you know what? I'm going to come down there and I'm going to be their shepherd. And I will bind the sheep and I will feed them and I will heal them and I will go after the lost sheep and I will protect and I will care about the least of these. I will. 14 times he says, I will. And then he says, I'm going to send my servant, David. We know that's Jesus. And Jesus shows up. And one of the most prominent images he gives of himself is that he is the good shepherd. Amen. And then leadership rises up within the church. And what is the most prominent title that is given to the leaders of the church? They are pastors, which is the Latin word for shepherd. Shepherds. To know. To lead. To protect and to feed the people of God. And so instead of neglecting shepherding, all in the name of progress, all in the name of growing bigger and bigger churches, what does the Bible teach us to do? To appoint godly men, deacons, servant leaders, to be the extending arms of the shepherds. Because the shepherds can't be everywhere, but to be the extending arms of the shepherds, to be closer to people, to be able to know them, to help organize care, and to inspire and fight for unity. Do you see it? It's right there in the text. That leads us to what we are doing here as a church, beginning this morning over the next several weeks. Deacon nominations. Deacon nominations. As we walk through meaningful membership, as we've spent the spring looking at how culturally our view, our focus of what it means to be a church member has really waned. One of the things is to say is that the church has a responsibility to get organized, to be able to care for the people. Well, that's why we're rolling out covenant care. That's why it matters. So that you can have a deacon that knows you, that will call you once a quarter and pray for you and your family. That way there can be an organized system in place, because we do care, but I can't be everywhere. So what are we asking? We're asking for you, congregation, to pray for godly men that you have seen, that have a good reputation, filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with wisdom, that you want to be an extension of the pastors, to help, to get organized, so that we can lovingly and appropriately care for all of our members. As you work through this text, what you'll realize is that deacons are called to be servant leaders. Servant leaders. This is important because we get it wrong in a lot of our churches. Our view of deacons. It's why I took an entire Sunday to walk through so that you see exactly what's going on here. Deacons are not pastors in the sense that they don't have to have the ability to teach. Doesn't mean they can't. It means it's not required for the job description. And therefore, deacons do not make the theological decisions for the church. Now, many of you have been a part of churches where the deacons are functioning like pastors or elders. Okay? That wouldn't fit this context, the biblical context. But deacons are also not just servants. Okay? They're not just servants. They're an extension arm of pastors, of shepherding. They're servant leaders. They're very needed. They're very necessary. And here's the deal. There's an empowering, a rising up from within the congregation to select godly men filled with the Holy Spirit of good reputation and wisdom. Now, you may be a visitor today and you are thinking, gosh, this sure doesn't feel like church. It sort of feels like an organizational business meeting. Well, I want you to see a couple of important things that come out of this text. First of all, I want you to see how committed to the Bible we are in our structure and in how we function. I also want you to see how we continually call ourselves to care for the least of these, to be so mindful of how we're shepherding the people, and that we fight for unity. You may at times feel that we're a little cliquish, and I apologize for that. We don't want to be. We know that those are natural tendencies of natural behavior, but we are called to be filled with Christ, and we are called to be different, and we fight for that, and we talk about that. About getting out of our comfort zones and crossing those barriers of because it matters. And I also want you to see how important we think that it is that every member that you would pray for and raise up leaders. How important that is. It doesn't come from me. We don't say, Pastor, could you write down a handful of guys that you think would be great? No. You guys pray about it and have the awesome responsibility of raising up godly deacons. Now watch what happens. Verse 7. The word of God kept spreading, and the number of the disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem. So the church didn't neglect, okay? It didn't neglect the spread of God's word and the prayer and the importance of God's word. And it also didn't neglect shepherding. It fought to be healthy. It fought for what is true and what is right, not getting in this ditch, not getting in that ditch. And what did God do? He blessed them. Amen. And he blessed them with growth. Now, do not hear me in the least bit say that this is a formula for church growth. And that if we do this, oh, we're good, it's a formula for church growth. Not in the least bit. You cannot program God. But what I want you to notice is that God was with them. God was with them. What else could we want as a church except to know that God is with us, that we're fighting for what is healthy and what is right, and we're always wanting to be the best version of ourselves so that Jesus is honored and glorified? That God is with us, that we want the gospel to go forward and we want our people to be cared for. There were some tough days ahead. That's Stephen. He would be stoned right there in the streets of Jerusalem. But that was God's will. Because it would scatter the gospel and begin to take it outside of Jerusalem into Judea. So there are certainly no promises for what the Lord will do with us. Except we know that if he is with us, and that if we are holding on to important principles from his word, we win. Hallelujah. We can't lose. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the way that it instructs us. We thank you that you have entrusted to us the awesome responsibility of praying and raising up church leaders. And the important responsibility of wanting to care for each and every member. And not simply widows, as important as that is, but for each and every member. Father, as we prayed at the beginning, would you give us your vision? Would you direct our paths? As your people pray, would you raise up your leaders? Father, we don't know what's around the corner, but you have given us a burning desire and passion to see your name in lights, to see your gospel go forward, for you to change us and to change our community right here in Boerne, God, to see your gospel go to the ends of the earth. Father, we know that there is so much that you have tasked us with and that you desire for us to accomplish, all for the glory of your name. That is your vision and your will. But God, we have to be healthy. We have to care for every new member that comes along. We can no longer accept large numbers being forgotten and fallen through the cracks. Help us, Father. Help us to shepherd your people well, because that is your desire. That is your desire. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.